the hit. Now it does have snap. Okay? So if the punch is coming straight, okay? Make sure you can see. Okay? If the punch is coming straight, here, imagine what happens here. If he moves into me, boom, it's gonna cave. So this is an ineffective point. Ineffective. But then right when I start to straighten up, boom, okay, see? So this type of punching is imaginary. It only works under one condition, that the impact happens just when, oh, it's straight, oh, okay, there. So it only works there. So if you practice and teach your students like that, you're teaching them that, oh, your opponent can only be there. He cannot be moving at you. Or your plotting solution of the punch can only be such that he cannot move. If he moves 3 inches in, you're gonna get jammed. And your punch is gonna be like this, and he's gonna move in, oh, and you're gonna break your wrist, or your elbow's gonna flap. Well, this is the danger of overemphasizing the hip. Now, that looks powerful, right? But if he walk in, see? I mean, it's absolutely, he just totally neutralized my punch. But if he didn't move in, I can hit him pretty good. And then the other scenario is the opposite. It's like the hip, and then this comes later. You know, that one is like a bowling ball where you throw it, but then it just moves on the inertia created at the very beginning. It doesn't have any self-power.
Right.
It just goes and goes, and it eventually, every foot that it moves, it slows down. It doesn't increase. So the one we want to do is the one where the punch goes, and then the hip is there to support the punch. And it's a completely, very difficult thing to do, especially after years of fire at the same time.
Yeah.
Because when you go to the makiwara now, it's like you immediately want to go, oh,
right.
You know, try going fast, and then the delayed reaction on the hip.
Right.
You just have to kind of practice it that way, then it starts making sense.
When you're hitting makiwara, then are you hitting contact here and then in? Or do you want to be turned?
On the makiwara, you don't twist, because all that's going to do is bleed you. Give me a sandpaper, let me just do that first and get it over with. No, on the makiwara, you twist in front, ahead of it, because you don't, you know, unless you want to put like, you know, thick leather glove on so that the rubbing is done on the outside. So maybe, you know, put some really thick leather gloves or wrap it good, and then you can twist. But if you're hitting somebody, so the proper way is always here. Straight line. As if you're standing next to a wall, you gotta go like this. And then impact. And then the penetration is there. But the elbow's not doing this on the way up. Okay? So it's very, very difficult to do. So I would say a good transition point would be just to stand in, let's say, how go that to your term, but just stand up so that you don't have to worry about the excessive rotation and just do it from this angle so that you start here. And then at the very end, use the hip, but just on a smaller scale, so that you don't automatically click into shooting from here if you're in a hakodachi. Because more than likely, you just fall into that habit. Okay?
Right.
So, I mean, if you do it in a cat stance, say if you were here, you can go like this. One, okay? There's your koshi. Okay? But if you have a second one, it's just hot. Because the koshi is spent.
Right.
So if you do the double punch, you don't go like this
right.
On the second punch. This means all your body weight is going back. Okay, any questions on hakodachi punching? Let's do do both sides. Okay, bye. Right.